20 seconds.
We note that any views expressed on Cayman Crosstalk do not necessarily reflect or represent the views of Compass Media, its staff, or contributors. Individuals who choose to call or comment do so at their own risk and should ensure that they comply with all laws and regulations, including those relating to defamation and privacy. Have your say on 233-1019, WhatsApp message 324-1019, or find us on Facebook at Cayman Crosstalk. This is Cayman Crosstalk on Rooster 101, leading Cayman Man's conversation.
Oh, land of soft, fresh breezes and budding trees so fair, with thy Creator's glory reflected everywhere. Oh, sea of palest emerald, merging to darkest blue, whene'er my thoughts fly Godward, I always think of you. Dear verdant island set in blue Caribbean Sea, I'm coming very soon. Shrines thee yet, homeland fair Cayman Isle, I cannot thee forget.
Good morning, Cayman. This is Chanda V, your host for Cayman Crosstalk. How you guys doing on this wonderful Monday? Did it come too fast for y'all? All right, don't worry about it. We're going to get you back to school, back to work, all of the good stuff this morning. I'm going to take you in and have a nice ride in. Oh gosh, I hope you guys left early because you know it's back to school. So we're going to be talking about a whole bunch of things. As I promised, some more of that border reopening press conference conversation, getting some answers to all of the questions that we have. Maybe not all of the answers, but we'll deal with a lot of the questions. But all right, so we'll get to that as well as some back to school announcements. Just a quick reminder before we head off into the news that yes, school in session. If you missed the orientation scheduled for Friday, the 27th of August, that's now happening today, Monday, the 31st of August. All government and primary and high schools, including Lighthouse School and Little Cayman Education Services, will reopen for all students on Tuesday, the 31st of August. So just so you know, in case you're already making your way out there, you need to be there or not, right? All right, guys, so a little coffee and coaching coming up for you around 8 o'clock. And, of course, our friend Anne-Marie Stephens from NAYA doing Marketing Monday. We're going to be talking about having the right business and marketing tools. All right, that's what we have lined up for you today. Great, great session. And we're going to get some news. Sorry, getting a little tongue-tied. We're going to get some news. It's early. It's Monday. All right, we all got to get back into the flow. We'll be right back with more Crosstalk after this.
On Monday, the 30th of August, I'm Caroline James with your headlines from the Cayman Compass newsroom. This weekend, Travel Cayman confirmed that a number of alleged breaches of quarantine have occurred at private residences over the past 2 weeks. All the infractions were reported to authorities by members of the public. According to a statement issued by the Travel Oversight Agency, the alleged breaches involved people in mandatory isolation, engaging with members of the public, and exchanging items in breach of COVID-19 protocols. Travel Cayman said all the alleged breaches were reported to the police and are currently under investigation. In many instances, individuals were placed in quarantine at the instruction of the Medical Officer of Health and were warned for intended prosecution by the RCIPS, Travel Cayman said. In this statement, Public Health said it would like to reassure the community that the infractions were isolated and there is no cause for public health concern. And the number of sharks being killed in Cayman's waters is increasing. The latest figures from the Department of Environment revealed that up to Thursday, the 26th of August, 27 dead sharks have been reported, which is 11 more than the 16 dead reported in 2019. COVID restrictions and lockdown in 2020 meant the DOE logged just one report of a dead nurse shark that year. This count, however, is assumed to be inaccurate. For these and other of the nation's top headlines, visit caymancompass.com.
Cayman Crosstalk is leading gay man's conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
All right, everybody, welcome back. It's Monday, and it's a school Monday. So I hope you guys got all of your supplies and everything ready as you were heading back to school, because I know how it is. There's a lot going on. I hope you took advantage of all of the back to school drives if you needed those. So we had a lot. It's been an intense last few weeks for everybody. So whether you were going back to school or not having to deal with it, but you were just trying to be on the road while all the parents were doing their back to school stuff, or whether you were impacted by Tropical Storm Grace and had some, you know, post-traumatic stress over Tropical Storm Ida. There's just been a whole lot going on in Cayman, in the world. So, you know, we just have to be careful how much of this media and how much of this energy we're taking in. So I just want you guys to do this with me. Take a deep breath. All right, it helps. I don't know if anybody, some of you might not even have like really had a deep breath or breathed properly, all this anxiety, all of this stuff. So take a couple deep breaths, do it as you need it. It's gonna be okay. First day back to school, the traffic's probably a little cray cray. I promised you a little hack of the last on Friday, and thank you. I just wanna say thanks to everybody who tuned in on Friday. You guys were of the utmost help. You, as you know, we weren't streaming. We had a little bit of a different show. We had just a radio show on Friday, but thank you guys who all participated, sending me all of the alerts is from your different social media groups, and as you saw things opening and reopening so that we could get that information to everybody. You were definitely a part of the production team on Friday, so I just wanted to say a big shout out to everybody who wrote in and all the help that you guys gave me, so big thank you for that. Also just want to give a big shout out to our sponsors at Yellow for backing us on the streaming side. So we're up and running again. Lenny's here. Lenny's back in studio. I'm not flying solo today, and I'm happy to have him here because this is the A team right here, and you know, we make magic. This is where we make the magic happen in the studio. So very happy to have my teammate back this morning. All right, what else do I got for you? And of course, can't forget Walk and Roll, our friends over there. So maybe do a giveaway this morning. We'll see, because we have a lot to talk about. But maybe we'll do that closer to the 8 o'clock hour. So stand by for that. I know everybody's busy trying to get out the house, get on the road. So I'm not going to complicate your life any further by trying to give you some free food. But we're going to have that a little bit later. What else do we have going on? So on a sadder note, big condolences, sending lots of love and prayers and well wishes and condolences to the Wolf family. Some of you will have seen in the news that Dr. Wolf passed away at 90 years old. So just sending a lot of love to his family and the friends and family. Okay. And we also have, we have a lot going on in terms of announcements. So there's been quite a few. I read the school one already, but just for you all, if you were, you know, missed it just at the start of the show, I did read about the Department of Education Services advisory last week. Things were a little bit shaken up. So Friday, there should have been some orientations that happened. That's now going to happen today. And all government primary and high schools, including Lighthouse School and Little Cayman Education Services, will reopen for students Tuesday, the 31st of August. That's tomorrow. All right? So everybody's in tomorrow, and then any orientations that were missed on Friday is happening today. All right, so hopefully you got that memo in time and you know what you're doing, but I'm sure we'll all figure it out, because this is just how it goes back to school. All right, so on that education note, I also want to continue and say a big congratulations to Shamari Scott, the new chairman of the Education Council. So this happened after he was appointed by cabinet as the new chairman of the Education Council, replacing Dan Scott, who had been the head of the council since 2017. Dan Scott, managing director of EY, took up the role after an amendment was made to the education law in 2016. So a few years, they're not an overly long period, as we may have seen with some other boards and other councils that have been established. So we're having a change over here. Mr. Scott's chairmanship was, his term as chairman was set to expire on the 31st of August. So he did tell the Cayman Compass that having served for almost 4 years, he felt that it was time to step away. It has been a privilege to work with an incredible group of persons on the Education Council as its various subcommittees. So at some point, separately, Health City is going to be coming back next week with Medical Mondays, because this is our last summer, quote-unquote summer segment. Summer's come to an end now, so we were doing Marketing Mondays, and Anne-Marie was filling that spot for us. So Shamari and his team at Health City will be back, and maybe we'll have to have him on separately at some point to talk to him about his new role as the head of the education the Education Council. So that should be an interesting conversation, because we've had a lot of conversations about education in here, what's working, what's not working, and there's a lot of concerns. So also just finding out exactly what the council does, what they're responsible for. I like to dig down into those little details and get a better understanding, because when we have questions and when things are, whether they're going right or wrong, or if it's policy decisions or enforcement decisions, we need to know who's at the core of making those decisions, right? So always really, really good to know. And then I just wanted to read out some of the other appointments on there, because just so you know the changes to the board, we also have LaToya Francis is on there as well. We've had her in talking about policy and education and her story, so I'm really, really happy to see her on there as well. But just so you know who the other board members are, it's going to be Mr. Herbert Crawford, Krishan Welcome, Jacqueline Ebanks, Bernice Scott, Giovanni Bodden, Claudette Lazari, Jonathan Tibbetts, Stephen Tatum, Daryl Rankin, Cindy Scotland, Tasha Porter, LaToya Francis, and Lasanio McLaughlin. He's serving as secretary. So, all right, that's your board. That's your new education council. And be nice to have them in at some point. So we'll reach out to them and find out what's going, what their plans are, and get a little bit more information on what it is that they do exactly. So, all right, any more back to school stuff? Nope. All right. Let's just go into a quick other. There's a couple other appointments made as well while we're on that note. And it was the appointment of two new young people. Where did that go? All right, guys. Sorry. It's Monday. We all feeling it. There was two more appointments to the Premier's office. I seem to have lost that tab. But it's going to be taking place for the Premier's social media team. And that is Nicholas Da Costa, I believe. And then there's another young lady, and I can't remember her name off the top of my head. But it's she's going to be in charge of the climate change. I was trying to find it for you really quick, but I'll come back with that on the news side a little bit later on. I don't want to sit here and bore you all to death. So what else is happening? Also, a big shout out to Miss Teen Azaya Thomas. So we have a new Miss Teen 2021-22. Our friend Andrella Harris from the Compass side was part of the emceeing of that. So I think he had a little fun there at the end. Thankfully he didn't have a Steve Harvey moment, but he did have some fun, and he played with the audience a little bit. I watched a little bit of it on social media. So we have all of that happening as well. So one of the let's see where we're at with time. When we come back, I'm going to take a quick break, but I'll tell you where I'm going with this conversation this morning, just in case you're like, where is she? What is all of this about? What are we talking about? So we have all the back to school stuff. Traffic is definitely a lot heavier. And I saw some stuff about, traditional Cayman back to school also includes Zentel. And for those of you who don't know what that is, it's kind of like, it's a deworming medication. So Apparently, it's typically, I didn't grow up like this, so if you want to take my Caymanian card away for this one, I didn't grow up like this, but it makes sense. I saw what they were saying. It's like a healthy gut, healthy mind. That was what the post was kind of relaying, and fair enough. Your summer, you slack off, so you need to get, get your body back on track and everything, and, you're outside playing, whatever. So it's really, just part of a good, healthy gut care from what I'm understanding. Did a little bit of research on it, and read some of the comments. So this is like a back to school practice for the kids, making sure that they're healthy, making sure that there's nothing else going on in their intestinal system. Even things like sushi that we eat, there's little parasites, little things in there. So healthy gut, healthy mind. I think a lot of people can back that up. But what I really wanted to go into in this conversation when we come back is I started thinking, okay, people use Zentel, cool. That's, they're using it for the purpose it is supposed to be used for. And then on the other half of this coin, the other side of this coin, we have ivermectin, which is another parasite antibacterial type medication that people use for parasites, right? So it's not an antiviral, but we have this whole COVID conversation around whether ivermectin is a thing. So are we using it right? Are we using it for purpose? Does it have any properties? And I am not a scientist, but I'm just posing these questions because this is what I'm seeing and these are the conversations I see people having around this situation. So we are going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we will continue down this conversation and then make our way through the border reopening press conference briefings. As I told you, there was a Q&A at the end of it, and a lot of people don't always stay. It's a two-hour press conference, so people just kind of usually stay for the first part, the highlights, maybe the first half hour, 45 minutes, but there were some really good questions, clarifying questions being asked at the end, so I thought, let's go through those, and please let me know if you do have any other questions. Message me at 324-1019. I'm also hanging out on the Crosstalk Facebook page, so if you have any questions, you can send them there as well, and I'll do my best to see if there's answers in here. Also printed out the border reopening plan, because a lot of what I was seeing in that press conference briefing was, it's in the plan, and I know a lot of us don't take the time to read the plan. I'm also guilty of that. We're busy, there's a lot going on, we don't really understand it, it's subject to change, so we kind of just take the alert as it comes, as we move through these phases. But it's all out there, the information's there, I've printed it out, so maybe we can get some answers from that as well, and just kind of keep track of what's going on. And, we'll go into some of the other conversations around the vaccine and whatnot before we go into coffee and coaching and Marketing Monday later on in the morning. So, quick break. We'll be back. I'm going to go anywhere. More Crosstalk after this.
This hour of Cayman Crosstalk is powered by Walk and Roll, the ideal place to relish Thai, Malaysian, Indonesian, and Filipino cuisines. For dine-in, take-out, or delivery, visit walkandroll.ky or call 949-0168. More of Cayman Crosstalk, brought to you by Walk and Roll, is next on Rooster 101.
Looking for a new pizza joint with that perfect crust? My car needs a bit of a tune-up, and my pregnant wife needs something from the pharmacy. So I turned to the printed yellow directory, and in an instant, the pizzas are ordered, the oil change is booked, and the thing that I'm not allowed to say out loud has been purchased for my wife. Problem solved. When you need something quick, do yourself a favor. Flip through the printed yellow directory. Stop searching, start finding. Yellow, we know local.
When it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
Cold case. It's a phrase no investigator likes to stamp on a crime file. Here in the Cayman Islands, there are at least 20 such cases. Join us at the Cayman Compass as we bring you a
3-1019.
All right, everybody, welcome back. So it's 7:20. Hopefully you've already left and you're having a smooth ride in. Oh, okay, my music was going longer than I thought, sorry. I totally was like, why is that still playing? Gosh, guys, you'd swear I have the school-aged child that I had to get ready and get to school this morning. It's just one of those days. So, all right, what else do we got? We got going on for you is, let's see. So definitely want to play this video for you from the press briefing of the 25th of August. So I know we're like 5 days behind. It's okay, the information is still relevant. Printed out this plan. There's the summary, which just kind of covers like the brief plan, and it's a one pager. And then there's like this whole legal size document that's 5 pages long that really outlines all of the different parts of the plan. But while we are, you know, before we get into the nitty gritty, I think it's important that we just go through this part of the, like, let's listen to some of the questions, because I know there were some other questions that came in and people are a little bit nervous about where this is going. And so I wanted to have some of these questions as well. And then we'll get back into this whole ivermectin, quarantine breaches, boosters, yada, yada, yada. Let's just find out. Let's hear where we're at first. So, Lenny, let's see if we can get this rolling.
All right.
All right, guys.
Beginning with Ralph from the Canadian Times.
Hey, good afternoon, Donna. Thank you. Good afternoon, members of the panel. Thank you for your heartfelt presentations. They're hard act to follow. Yes, I'm going to have just a few brief questions. I think Dr. Rodriguez is here, and I'll send all my questions to him. By the way, I have my two vaccinations, and I hope that we pass the 80%.
Thank you.
And Dr. Rodriguez, just can you briefly tell us what plans have you increased the preparations for the increase of cases that may follow the reopening? Is the staffed up? Do you have the PPEs and stuff that you should have? Because it is a fact that we will have additional cases when we open the borders. And so I just wanted to ask the question.
That we will have cases when we open the border and also community transmission. We do have all the necessary PPE and all the requirement equipment on island, not only at the HSA, but island-wide to face an increased number of cases of coronavirus on island. When it comes to management of this case from a public health perspective, definitely we'll continue to do contact tracing that we were doing before, and we will continue to monitor these patients very closely. As we actually do it now, we're still having some positive cases now from travelers. We continue to monitor these cases very closely on a day-by-day call, everyday call by public health. We'll continue to do that. So the island is prepared to face an increased number of cases in the Cayman Island once we open the border. That's what is expected. However, I've been said many times today, if we continue with a good number, with vaccination number, we have the protection. And we are confident that we won't get an alarming number of cases, severe cases and death, like other countries are experiencing around the world.
Okay, thank you. I have one more question, sir. I've noticed recently that we have over 800 people this week in isolation. Can you say whether they are isolating in their homes or in, or what percentage are isolating in their homes or government facilities?
The majority of the persons that are isolation are present isolating at home. We still have a percentage of these of travelers isolating at the different government facilities, but a great majority of them are isolating at home at this stage.
Okay, thank you.
All right, just jumping in there because, yes, I don't know if you heard what I heard, 800 people. 800, that's a lot of people. I know, though, that some of them may be family member. So like if you were traveling and you're coming back into a quarantine at home situation. So it's like if my parents went away and they came back and we all agreed that we would quarantine for the 2 weeks. If we were all vaccinated and decided that they were going to quarantine at home and we were all going to quarantine together, then that those numbers might also include family members who were not traveling. Do you get my drift? Like, so it's not necessarily that they were exposed. It's precaution, but that's still a lot of people. And even if we just a very conservative estimate, say, let's just half that and say that 400 of those people could have been reasonably exposed to the virus. And let's just half that, 200 people that could have been potentially exposed to the virus. That's still a lot of people, right? So just want you to keep in track, like compared to our population. And I know those figures are still waxing and waning, but you know, on average, I think we can all agree that it's somewhere in the 65,000 region. And ESO actually just sent out some more details. So we'll get you those numbers. There's still some clarification because that's what the last ESO report handed out last week, I think it was just recently, and they announced that at the press conference as well. So they're looking, I still haven't gotten a clear answer about what that 80% target is. Apparently it doesn't really matter for right now because they're moving along with on September 9th with this next phase, and we'll talk a little bit more about what that is and recap you. But we're going into phase 3 on the 9th of September, and there's still protocols, there's still vaccinations in place, I think there's still some quarantining, so we'll get you more information on that. But just so you know, just for the purpose of this conversation, 800 people are in quarantine. So when we start talking about breaches, when we start talking about community transmission, that number starts to look very important. So just wanted to point that out. All right, we're going to continue.
Thank you, Doc. And Donna, my last question is for the Minister of Tourism, Mr. Brent. We have been home for a number of months, having to travel, and residents of the Cayman Islands have always been traveling on a regular basis. Of course, with the borders being opened in a couple of weeks, what would be your recommendation to those of us who like to travel abroad?
Well, considering the fact that I haven't left in 2 years myself, it'd be kind of hard to tell somebody not to go anywhere. But if they can resist it for now, particularly because most of the jurisdictions like the United States are going through what they're going through, we would encourage persons to stay home. But obviously, if you have other matters you have to address, then so be it, because after September 9th, we go to your normal scheduled flight, so to speak, by those airlines that are coming. So it's no longer a repatriation flight. So commercial flights are going to be open to whatever schedule that is agreed to by the airport's authority. So ultimately, nobody can stop you at that stage. But if you do travel, take every precaution you can possibly can. Carry your mask with you. Try to stay away from major crowds. Stay with people that you know, those who are safe. And make sure you're vaccinated before you go. That would be my only encouragement, to keep yourself safe at this point. But if you can, stay home, if you can handle the wait longer.
Yeah. Just one follow-up. In your conversation with the airlines.
All right, guys, just a quick reminder on this, too. Remember last week we had the airports authority in talking about the changes to the parking. So like it, love it, hate it. Doesn't matter, it's happening. So the Cayman Islands Airport Authority is going to, from the 31st of August, only authorize public transportation, and tour operators will be allowed to drop off and pick up passengers in front of the main terminal. So now you have to go into that short-term parking. If you're less than 5 minutes, it's free. And I think all of September they're waiving the fees as well. So, but just a reminder that you're not going to be able to drive around. You need to go into that short-term parking and then pull all the way into the, making sure I got my signs right, onto the right side, and then you'll be directly in front of where you would normally do the drop-offs, all right? I'm sure there'll be people guiding and as we start this process, because it's happening today, but I'm sure we're going to be, you know, there'll be people out there, and they have promised us good customer service. So if you're out there and you have to go to the airport and experience any of this, then please do let us know. I'll also do a quick check of where the vaccine, I didn't ask them how that's going to be operated, but I would assume it's the same situation, but I'll just double check that as to where we're at with the vaccine locations as well. All right, so we're going to continue listening to our video now.
Did they indicate that they would have mandatory requirements for vaccinated passengers?
No, we have not established that yet. I've been hearing some whispering. I do have a scheduled update next week, Monday. Unfortunately, Grace has caused some hurdles in the way of the scheduled meetings to know what's happening at the airport and the airline scheduling. So hopefully I can give more of an update to the public in short order. But I do suspect that may happen. Obviously, different countries have different regulations based on their constitutional rights and so forth. So it may vary from airline to airline.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Don. That's it for me.
Okay, thank you very much, Ralph. I'd like to now call on Wendy from CNS.
Thank you, Donna. Hello, everyone. Can I speak to Dr. Williams first, please, if I may? Thank you. Can I just check with you? A lot of the tests that are coming back positive, we now are not testing people at the airport. So these people are presumably getting positive results after their 5 days in isolation. So that's when we're getting all of these positive tests that are now coming.
But they're getting test positive after quarantine. But that can be on day 6, on day 11, on day...
Right, sorry, 15. Yes, in some people. So what's that telling us about the situation? Are we going to reintroduce the testing at the airport at any point between now and 14th of October?
That's definitely a decision for the government to make. We are in discussion also on the program board or the possibility of testing on arrival, and we will send a recommendation to government, and government will make a decision on that.
All right, guys, so this is another important question that I saw come up as well, because if we're talking about quarantining, our historic understanding of the virus was that it could incubate for a little while. If you know, even if you had a clear PCR test, we saw people coming in positive contact while they were traveling and then testing positive when they came back, even though they had the negative PCR test before leaving wherever they were leaving from that jurisdiction. So I think Wendy's question is very, very important, that if we have a reduced quarantine period, even for vaccinated travelers, and you know they've come into contact, they're testing positive on day 6, day 7, day 11, then how do, you know, I guess it goes back to contact tracing, but what I'm trying to say here is the exposure, the risk of exposure is real. So if you're, again, on the fence, if you don't know, or if you're, you know, it is concerned, and maybe the question is, should we be reopening so fast? Do we really want to reopen? There is the tourism side that is saying yes and pushing for that. And understandably, there's people in that industry that do need more more income, and they're suffering from a source of livelihood. And then there's the risk. There's the real risk, which we all know, and the Premier has said over and over and over again that the risk is real. It's coming to our doorstep. This is it. October 14th, be ready, get your vaccinations. If that's what you're going to do, do it now. Don't hold off any longer. And just on that note, the clinics are closed on Monday. They're not doing the vaccinations at the airport anymore. It's all that whole vaccination operation is being shifted to Caymana Bay from Tuesday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. So as of this moment onward, it's basically, clinics are closed on Monday. Let me just start this over, guys. Clinics are closed on the Mondays for here until the end of September is the calendar that I have. That the clinics are closed on Mondays. Caymana Bay is the place to go Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, and Saturday. And then on Thursdays, they're doing the more specific clinics, like in the district communities. So Savannah, Prospect, West Bay, that's where they'll be targeting the specific districts on Thursdays, okay? So we'll post this schedule up again, and it can be found at hsa.ky. They have their public health section on the website. And again, I also know that they're trying to do the certified digital verifications, and they're asking people to register on the portal. So if you've already been vaccinated, then make sure that you register so you can get your digital certification as well. All right, so we're going to take a quick break, go to the news, and when we come back, we'll continue listening to, if you've been tuned in and you're listening and you wonder what you were listening to, it was the question and answer portion of the press briefing last week, the COVID press briefing. And again, I thought some the reporters that were there had some very interesting questions that I thought we need to listen to, because maybe we didn't get that far when we were listening to it on our own. All right, guys, so we're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Crosstalk after this.
This hour of K-Man Crosstalk is powered by Walk and Roll. Get rid of the cooking chores and give yourself a much-needed break by ordering Walk and Roll. They're sure it'll boost your spirits and make you happy. Visit walkandroll.ky or call 949-0168. More of K-Man Crosstalk brought to you by Walk and Roll is next on Rooster 101.
Looking for a new pizza joint with that perfect crust. My car needs a bit of a tune-up, and my pregnant wife needs something from the pharmacy. So I turned to the printed yellow directory, and in an instant, the pizzas are ordered, the oil change is booked, and the thing that I'm not allowed to say out loud has been purchased for my wife. Problem solved. When you need something quick, do yourself a favor. Flip through the printed yellow directory. Stop searching, start finding. Yellow. We know local.
When it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
The 30th of August, I'm Caroline James with your headlines from the Cayman Compass newsroom. This weekend, Travel Cayman confirmed that a number of alleged breaches of quarantine have occurred at private residences over the past 2 weeks. All the infractions were reported to authorities by members of the public. According to a statement issued by the Travel Oversight Agency, the alleged breaches involved people in mandatory isolation, engaging with members of the public, and exchanging items in breach of COVID-19 protocols. Travel Cayman said all the alleged breaches were reported to the police and are currently under investigation. In many instances, individuals were placed in quarantine at the instruction of the Medical Officer of Health and were warned for intended prosecution by the RCIPS, Travel Cayman said. In this statement, Public Health said it would like to reassure the community that the infractions were isolated and there is no cause for public health concern. And the number of sharks being killed in Cayman's waters is increasing. The latest figures from the Department of Environment revealed that up to Thursday, the 26th of August, 27 dead sharks have been reported, which is 11 more than the 16 dead reported in 2019. COVID restrictions and lockdown in 2020 meant the DOE logged just one report of a dead nurse shark that year. This count, however, is assumed to be inaccurate. For these and other of the nation's top headlines, visit caymancompass.com.
Cayman Crosstalk is leading gay man's conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
Call me. call me because I got questions and I want to talk. And I know you guys have questions too. So as we're hearing, as we go through the Q&A section of this press conference that happened last week, there's lots of little things coming on. As you just heard in the news, there was quarantine breaches. So when people ask me why I got vaccinated, so Minister Bryan asked, you know, to explain to people, tell people, use your social media platforms. I'm here, so this is a platform, big platform. Let me explain again, in case you missed it, why I got vaccinated. So back before the elections, we had a couple different things happening. We had, one, early elections being called. Two, we had breaches in quarantine. We had, three, Delta variants started, right? So I'm here looking at all these things, and, you know, I probably would have been happy not getting no jug in my arm and just wearing my mask or just keeping to myself because I'm already a homebody. You all see me in the public, but you don't really see me in the public, right? So you see me here and very public. But those were the concerns I had. If anybody breaches quarantine, so although they're talking about these being very isolated events, maybe it was somebody, they were saying engaging with members of the public, handing over things. So it might be, quote unquote, a mild incident. But in my opinion, I can't afford to be sick. I'm self-employed. I'm an entrepreneur. I have my own business. I can't afford to just take time off to be sick. And I don't want to be sick. I don't like being sick. So I was like, let me get this because I don't know who's the new government going to be and what they're going to do and what's going to happen. I don't know I'm not going to be insulting. I want to be, but I'm not going to be. I don't know which person is going to take it upon themselves to think they know better than, you know, the medical system and breach quarantine. I also, you know, just don't know how I'm going to react to COVID, especially with all these variants, even though I'm relatively young, healthy. I don't know how it's going to treat me. So I don't want to find out. So let me just go take the vaccine. If that's the number one thing I can do, all right, I might grow a tail. I might get a new eyeball in the middle of my forehead. I might have some side effects. To me, the risk of not having to go through what I hear and see other people going through and not having to risk dying prematurely, that was enough for me. That's enough for me. Mightn't be enough for you, but that was my story, and that's what I'm sticking to. All right, guys. So just to recap before we go back into listening to this Q&A section, because there's still quite a bit to get through there. We are moving into phase 3. That's a limited introduction of tourism. That's starting September 9th. So it's still securely verified vaccinated tourists age 12 and over. So there is no unvaccinated tourists. There are no 12 and unders allowed. So only just the regular what we've had so far, plus now securely verified vaccinated tourists over the age of 12. They're still going to have to get authorizations from Travel Cayman to come into the country. So it's not quite a free-for-all. You can't just book a ticket and come in. You still have to go through that step of the process. And vaccinated travelers with securely verifiable vaccination documents, 5-day quarantine. So we still have a quarantine period. I'm okay with this up to this point. October 14th still kind of makes me nervous, but we'll see. And I know that they're using this to test the plan, and a little bit later they're going to be talking about and I do want to get to that point before we move on to the next part of our, you know, the next segment later on at 8 o'clock. I do want to get to all of this. You still have to have PCR tests, but I just want to give you guys an update of where we're at with this particular phase we're coming into on September 9th, that they still will have to have the pre-travel PCR test as well. So you heard Wendy Ledger talk about just before the break, she was questioning, are we going to have more tests at the airport considering people are showing up later? Are we going to maybe go back to that? So they're taking all those things into consideration as we work our way through the experiences happening in these phases. Just want to make sure there's nothing else. Oh, GPS tracking has not been required for vaccinated, securely verifiable vaccinated travelers. So that's the other thing. All right, those were the key major points. So of course, this document has a lot more information in it. And one of the things they're going to discuss, and I want you guys to hear it firsthand, is what happens with the outbreak. So that'll be coming up in just a few minutes. So we're going to continue listening to this, the reporters' questions and answers session of the 25th of August press COVID press briefing.
Also, do you have any figures that can tell us the percentage of people that are testing positive that have been vaccinated?
I have that. We have that information. I don't have it on top of my head, but I can share it with you.
Okay, that's great. Also, I don't know whether you can answer this, but it's just to try and counter the narrative because it does seem to have taken hold on certain social media platforms, and it seems that there isn't a counter narrative coming from government, that our death rate has increased this year rapidly, and that's why these people are able to suggest that it is as a result of the vaccine. Are you able to say whether we have collected death rate figures this year that are in any way excessive compared to previous years?
Actually, I can tell you as a fact that we have not that,
that data,
and the death rate so far this year is lower than in previous years.
Fantastic.
As a fact.
That's all I've got for you. I'll ask you, I'll send you an email for the percentage figures for the. Okay, just a very few questions. Can you tell us what's happening about the legislation, Mr. Premier, regarding the compulsory mandatory vaccine for work permit holders?
Yes. Wendy, if you allow me a second, I want to thank His Excellency for being here. I want to thank my colleagues for being here. I want to thank the incredibly compelling, poignant stories that came from both our colleague, Minister Juliana Connolly, O'Connor Connolly, and Dr. Charles. Very, very incredible, poignant stories, real life examples of people, the level of engagement and the issues that are involved and the risks that are involved. So thank you very much, both of you. Appreciate it so much. On that point, on the draft legislation, we are working through that. I think I have what is probably a final draft, if not very close to it. I'll be handing it over to my colleague, the Deputy Premier, who has responsibility for WORC, with a C, as my colleague says, to take forward through Cabinet and to have it tabled in the LA. I intend to exercise the special circumstances or exceptional circumstances provision of the Constitution to provide shorter notice to allow it to be dealt with quickly.
No rough date?
Sometime, I suspect we'll have it tabled in the next within the next week or so. And then I haven't decided whether exactly how short the notice is going to be, but it is not a very significant bill. So I don't think it's going to require, and we've talked about this for some time now, so I don't think it's going to require a lot of consultation time.
Thank you. The only other thing really I wanted to talk.
All right, guys, so a couple little things there. You heard that the death rates are lower, so I just wanted to point that out because I think we've been hearing all kinds of information that people were dying from the vaccine. So I'm glad that question was asked, that it's that's not that direct correlation. So that's an interesting point, as well as these mandated regulatory this up change to the immigration laws, so that work permits renewals will carry this mandate of the vaccine. So waiting to see how this pans out. I will reserve my comments until later, but I am waiting to see how this pans out. There are some questions, and again, if you guys have questions, please text me at 324-1019, as well as I want to know them before I get the people in front of me. So if you're thinking, I like this, I don't like this, what is this going to mean, can they do it this way? Let me know sooner than later so that I am not, we're not waiting until we have the premier in front of us or legislators in front of us to ask these questions. The more you can give me in advance about what you want to know about and the questions you have, the better I can do my job. So, all right, guys, again, the number is 324-1019, and you can also message me on Facebook. All right, guys, so we're going to continue along this thread just for a little while longer because there are some other good points that have arisen in here.
Talk about was the vaccine campaign and what more is going to happen with the addition of like the clinics that you're talking about having in constituencies and the vaccine bus. Is there anything else that you're planning to try and counter some of this anti-vaxxer narrative that is getting quite, it's spreading on social media quite excessively now? It's coming out of a lot of places. It's on a lot of social media, it's even on the radio a lot, you know.
Well, speaking for myself, I intend to be very much engaged on all forms of media to try to address this issue. It is perplexing to me, as I mentioned earlier, that people that I regard as very capable and intelligent people can buy into some of this misinformation and let it influence their reasoning and their conclusions on whether they should take a vaccine or not. But I find that, speaking to people, engaging with people, talking with them about the issue, confronting their views on the issue, I think those are the ways that we can help to break through some of these resistant perspectives. So I feel we are, we're going, I'm sure all of my colleagues will be doing the same. We'll be engaging fully on different forms of social
media. Is there any plans to extend the vaccine clinics? Because now they've been closed on Mondays and they close early. Is there a plan to sort of open up the vaccine access more than we have already?
Yes, there are plans for that, and as we stated, we're extending it to our constituencies, and we're working closer with Public Health and HSA. Those will be coming out in the coming days. I know that we've seen a lot of resistance and hesitancy in those 16 to, let's say, 25, 30. And this does take a lot of work behind the scenes, understanding that we're dealing with our medical professionals and HSA's public health staff. But I'm hearing the outcry for more town hall meetings so persons can come and they can share and ask the questions to demystify a lot of it. And we're going to have to start using more of the younger persons out there that are very influential in social media in order to reach these younger persons here in Cayman. And I'm quite sure my colleague and I and the rest of the PAC government, Minister Brian, may actually have some other tricks up his sleeve that is supported by all of us. But more so, more engaging, coming down to their level, but using those influencers to really get to that specific target audience and age group, because that's where we're seeing the greatest hesitancy. And also, there are a lot of our Caymanian older persons that are just now coming forward, and we're hoping by giving a definitive date of October that we will see an uptake and FDA approval as well. So in very short days, and I'll definitely keep all of you in the media informed of these possible town hall meetings as best as we can.
Okay, great. Can I just
Wendy, if I
could just... I've got another question for you, so just let me ask it and then you can give me all in a thing. Can you just make it clear, on the 14th of October, people will still need to quarantine if they do not have verifiable, but anyone will be able to come at that point?
Correct.
Or is that on the 9th of September? Will anybody be able to come? Like, are you lifting, like, because at the moment, the only people that can come are friends, relatives...
The flights are no longer repatriation flights as of September the 9th.
So people won't have to go to Travel Cayman and say, oh, I'm a family member or I own a property or whatever. They can just be anyone.
Well, they do still have to do that process, but they're not restricted to travels. So because of the quarantining processes between September 9th and October 14th, you still have to do the Travel Cayman process to get the approval to come.
Right, so between 9th and 14th, still need approval.
Yes.
After the 14th, no approval.
Well, we have to go through those regs. Between now and then, we could definitely give you more updates at that time.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
I just wanted to add on to the question previously.
Yeah.
And particularly, yes, some tricks up my sleeve. I am appealing to everyone who's watching. We live in a world of many different pulpits, many different platforms, many different social media, from WhatsApp to Instagram to Facebook to, I don't even know what the latest one is now, TikTok. I make some myself sound so old, but my point is, you know what, if you've been vaccinated, I'm certain that you've made the decision for a reason. We need you to help us, help you, help everybody else. It's time for you to do your part. Get on your platform and say your piece. We're all in this together. I know that getting vaccinated is a very private thing. Some of us are okay with standing firm to say why we do it or why others should do it. And believe it or not, when people feel that they're not alone, they get the courage that is necessary. So I ask each and every one of you, tonight I want to see social media blasting everywhere with everybody giving 30 seconds of their reasons why they are vaccinated. Because your friend who may be watching, may be dealing with it privately and scared and don't know what to do, may see it and said, you know what, this is somebody I love, somebody I respect, and your words might be the encouraging words to make them do the right thing. This is about saving lives. So we ask you to help us do the right thing.
Thank you. That's all I need.
Okay, thank you very much. Wendy, I have lots of questions coming in from the public, but I'm going to ask a couple before we move on to Andrell from the Cayman Compass. One of the questions from the public is, will vaccinations be introduced in schools?
That's a health question.
Okay.
Well, I think just, I mean, Ms. Julie, you would prefer if I answer it? I think we have not considered anything along the lines of mandating vaccines in schools. You know, I can't say at this point that that would be an impossible consideration, but it depends on, I mean, we're obviously at this point we only have approval or emergency approval for children between the ages of 12 and 15. So it couldn't relate to those younger, those in primary school, for example. I suppose at some point in the future that may change. Those studies are ongoing at this point. I think we would have to take advice before we even considered anything like that, and we'd have to be clear that there was significant benefit in doing that, and there was significant risk that we're trying to address by making that sort of decision. But that is along the same lines as, you know, are we considering mandatory vaccinations for the country? And the answer is no, we're not considering that.
Okay, thank you very much, Premier Panton. One of the other questions is it being considered, or should it be considered, that once the borders open, that mass and social distancing should be happening again in public places?
I will say that if you look at the plan that we outlined previously, it did contemplate that we might have to reimpose public health protocols around masking and social distancing, mm-hmm. that people have been familiar with in the past. To be honest, I suspect that is going to have to be a very specific consideration for us. We're going to have to strongly consider that in various different scenarios, and that is something that we would be, as a government, seeking to consider. And if we decide to implement that on a mandatory basis, it would be done in the coming weeks, so that it is in time for the increasing risk after October 14th.
All right, guys, just a reminder, because we've had hurricane preparedness season, we've, you know, been caught off guard with the tropical storms, especially Grace. Are we going to get caught off guard with the risk? We have heard so much. The risk is here. The risk is at our doorstep. It is coming October 14th. Do not wait to go buy your hand sanitizer. Do not wait to go buy your masks. Please get your things in order and start practicing and preparing for your protocol. That was your public service announcement from Chanda V on Crosstalk. So, all right, I'm going to go back to this because we still have a lot to get through.
One final question. This might be for Dr. Sam. It relates to the smart cards or the digitized vaccination cards. Many people who got the vaccine, let's say from when vaccinations were available across the globe, they have paper vaccination cards as opposed to having them digitized. And they're Caymanians who want to come home, but they don't necessarily, they've been vaccinated, they don't necessarily want to do the quarantine, but they can't get that information transferred over digitally. Is this something that public health has had to deal with? And if so, what kind of advice would you give to persons who are in that position?
Okay, so we have two scenarios here. So everyone that has been vaccinated here in the Cayman Island, the HSA have been working with the ministry and others, and we will have an electronic card that could be securely verified in the first week in September. For those Cayman residents in the Cayman Island that have their vaccine in other jurisdictions that cannot be verified at this present, we're also working in a process to be able to, once we get this information, we can confirm that information internally, we'll add it to the database of the HSA, the CERNA electronic database, and we will be able to also produce an electronic card for them.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, we're going to move on. Thank you, Dr. Sam. We're going to move on now to Andrel Harris from The Compass.
Donna, while we await him come, I just want to give the public a little update as to one of the questions asked before about whether persons would have to be apply for travel to Cayman after September 9th. As per our reopening plan, up until January, which we hope that we'll eventually get to the all clear, so to speak, and welcome back, travel applications will be needed all the way to that point. Because even though a person may be vaccinated, for those who are not vaccinated, they too still have to go through a process of quarantining. So that will continue to be monitored if it has to extend past January, depending on the circumstances, and nothing conspires against us. Hopefully it will be done in January.
All right. Thank you, Minister Brian. Andrew?
Thank you. My first question is to Dr. Rodriguez as well. In the hot seat.
Hot spot.
Dr. Rodriguez, it was said that mandatory PCR testing would be in place for frontline staff, but that hasn't happened. It was also said that we would receive a definition of what constitutes as a frontline worker. Can we... that also hasn't been released. Why has that been the case, and when do you anticipate that a definition will be provided?
In my understanding is that they are currently working on the regulations for testing, PCR testing for frontline workers. Once this is ready, and they should be ready shortly, it will be made public. Who will be a frontline worker? That will also come up with a regulation, but definitely now anyone who have contact with travelers will be considered frontline workers. So everyone who work at the airports or the point of entry are considered frontline workers, and also from a healthcare provider.
Thank you. Premier Panton.
Yes, sir.
In light of the recent population statistics that were provided by the ESO, which clash with what the government had previously projected as Cayman's population, what figure is the government working with as far as the 80% target is concerned?
Well, you say clash. Both numbers come from the same Economics and Statistics Office. The one is just the 71,000 is just the upper range, and the 65,876, I think it is sort of the median. And we are at this point still sticking with the 71,000, but I think the reality is that given what has been transpiring with the Delta variant, this issue about an 80% target is sort of getting a bit fuzzy. I mean, we're here today to appeal to the people of the country to get vaccinated, and we need as many of our people vaccinated as possible. I've said before that if we didn't get to an 80% target, we would consider what the position was at the time and make a decision. At this point, we are looking to basically make that decision around the 1st of October. 30th September, 1st of October, 2nd of October, somewhere around that time period. I have had a conversation today with the Honourable Deputy Governor, who chairs the program board, and who gives us all excellent advice. And I've indicated to him that effectively we'd be asking them a week before that point to give us their perspective, their views on where we're at, what's happening in the outside world, and what their recommendation would be. And effectively, the day before we meet, I expect to have a full caucus meeting all day about this, knowing my colleagues, there is going to be it might even be 2 days, but effectively, I mean, this is a serious, serious issue, and we've got to do it justice. Nobody takes this very lightly. So we're going to get an update the day before we meet, or maybe even the morning that we meet, from the program board as to any changes that may be relevant to our discussion and consideration at that time. We have to act on and be informed by, and our actions have to be informed by, the best available information from the program board, from the various representative bodies that are on that board, and specifically from public health and Dr. Lee and Dr. Williams. So we are going to have our work cut out for us at that point to make a decision. I don't think any of us are afraid of making a decision. What we are afraid of is a situation where we have people who, for no good reason, end up being susceptible to COVID and getting very sick, possibly dying. None of us want to see that. None of us want to feel that. I mentioned earlier the situation with our colleagues in the BVI, and I know Premier Foy there, I can't imagine the pain that he must feel, or must have felt in over the past month and a half or so, of knowing people and losing those individuals, feeling the sense of responsibility for the people of his country. Those people who died were all unvaccinated. All unvaccinated. And there was the same challenges of vaccine resistance, vaccine hesitancy. We have somehow got to break through that. We have got to get to that better consciousness of ourselves, for people to get beyond that and realize that this is something that's very serious, and they've got to do it for themselves. They've got to do it for their families. They've got to do it for their neighbors, their community, and their country.
A few more quick questions. Governor Roper, of course, as has been stated by the panel several times, the COVID, the Pfizer vaccine has been approved by the FDA. We haven't heard any words of approvals from the UK just yet. Are you able to confirm or speak to the timeline on approval from the UK on the vaccine?
Well, I mean, it is approved by the UK. It's gone through very rigorous testing and trials, and the UK has approved the AstraZeneca and the Pfizer and I think Moderna as well. So the regulators have approved it. I mean, all these regulatory systems are slightly different. Each country does it in a different way, but the UK, the vaccines are approved in the UK. I'm not aware there is another process going on where we will get another approval. It's there.
Well, unfortunately, their website says it's approved for temporary use.
But that's been going on now for 9 months. So I don't think anyone should have any concern about that at all. The UK has vaccinated over 30 million people now with this vaccine, and as has been demonstrated today, these are incredibly safe, effective vaccines, and the UK would not be rolling them out in the way that it was unless it was fully convinced that these vaccines are safe. So I just think that's really not a relevant issue.
Perhaps Minister Bryan or Minister Turner might be able to take this one. Several people have been asking, in light of the proposed reopening strategies, when will the ban on people limits be lifted, the 500 indoor and 1,000 outdoor?
Be lifted? Oh, you're going the wrong direction, buddy.
Wrong direction.
When we go in towards increasing the risk of COVID spread, we're going to be reducing the numbers. Mm-hmm. Now, we haven't decided what that will be, but I can tell you the appetite of our colleagues are one that there may have to be a reduction of those numbers. What those ones will be, the Minister of Health will definitely share those because she's responsible for that area. Let's make her speak for herself, obviously, but wrong direction.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's definitely the wrong direction. As we stated here by more than one of my colleagues, we're increasing our risk after October 14th, so we will see, and this will be confirmed, that numbers, at least for the beginning phases, will go down in public gatherings. But again, there's more to that to come, because as a government, we have to do and meet with the program boards who guide us in regards to that. But definitely, as we get more of the opening, the numbers will go down.
Two final questions.
Andrea, I just want to add to that. If you go back and look at the details around our opening plan, you will see that it specifically says, as I mentioned earlier, that we would be contemplating reimposing public health protocols, which would be social distancing and masking. It also says that we might be contemplating reducing the gathering numbers, gathering restrictions. So at the moment, the gathering restrictions outdoors is 1,000, indoors is 500. We clearly said in the plan that we, I think it was after October 14th, we would be considering the possibility of reducing those numbers. So you may see further regulations changing the current restrictions and definitely reducing them, reflective of the increased level of risk.
All right, guys. So I've been trying not to jump in too much here because we're already going over the segment time I had allotted. But again, this is key information I feel like you guys need to have. And just on this note where we're talking about reducing the numbers of people in gatherings and whatnot, I have questions here. I have some hesitations. I have some concerns here because we're talking about reopening to, quote unquote, have some normalcy, to rebuild our tourism economy. So that's all well and good. I understand the premise of this, right? But are we not now impacting the other part of our economy? I really need to understand, like, how does that balance out when we have people here that are now, like, if you are in the events industry or if you are, you know, where we had a safe bubble, where we had a limit of 500 or 1,000 people, and then that's going to now be reduced. Are we going back? Suppose we have to go back to those numbers of 50 people or 100 people. Then doesn't that still impact the economy? Does the benefit outweigh the consequence? I am still very confused on what we think the numbers need to be looking like and what our expectations of reopening the borders and what those numbers are going to look like in terms of revenue versus where we're at now. So that's my big question coming out of this particular response. So I'm just going to continue, but I just wanted to note that for the record.
Now, we've seen a relative plateauing of the uptake of vaccines, and despite the various forms of vaccination drives. Premier Panton, would you support if the business community was to refuse to provide services or goods to unvaccinated people who do not fall within a medical exemption?
Can you repeat that for me?
Would you support if the business community was to refuse to provide services and goods to people who do not fall, or to unvaccinated people who do not have a medical exemption?
So you're asking if, for example, a restaurant can say we are only going to serve people who can demonstrate to us that they're vaccinated.
Yes.
And we're not going to serve people who are unvaccinated.
Yes.
I want to say in general that we support the business community imposing whatever level of restrictions they feel are important to and necessary to protect their staff, their customers, and their business reputations. I don't think it's, at this point, we're not going to be saying, yes, keep people who are not vaccinated from coming in. That is something that is up to them to decide. In fact, it may be something, and I've said this before in a statement in Parliament, that it is something that we might consider ourselves in terms of regulation. But it is not something at this point that we have a specific opinion on or promoting one way or another. I leave it entirely up to businesses to make that decision for themselves. But I support them making and having the right to make the decision that they feel is best to protect their staff and their other customers and their business reputation as a whole.
Final question.
All right, just before we move on to that final question, which is a good one about what happens if this all goes wrong. So hold on for that. I just want to say that, you know, again, these are these tricky gray areas, because when you see a restaurant or a gas station or a public place, it's kind of like a semi-public place, right? So it's a privately owned business that offers goods and services to the public, yet at the same time, they kind of have their, unless the government mandates otherwise, that they still have this ability to say how they want their business and their customers and, you know, who's your, again, going back to Anne-Marie's favorite statement here is, who's your ideal client? We've talked about this from a business perspective, right? So who are you marketing to? Are you, you know, so it becomes now these gray areas of a public-private business. And, you know, it's not the government, it's not healthcare, it's not someplace that is a public government-owned facility. These are private businesses that do offer goods and services to the public. And there's a whole area of law. I'll get somebody in to come in, give another perspective. So it's not just my perspective and understanding of what it is, but to discuss this in a little bit more detail, how that actually sits from a public business and whether you can be denied services and whatnot. All right. Okay. So we're just going to wrap up with this last question from Mr. Andrel Harris at the press conference last week.
Question is simply, in the event that the COVID transmission or community transmission of the virus takes hold, how swiftly would the borders be closed and are measures implemented to stem the spread?
I think in our reopening plan, we basically said that two separate clusters of infection would trigger an immediate assessment, public health assessment. Now, those, depending on what they are and exactly what the implications are, you know,
leading to hospitalisation,
requiring hospitalisation. That's correct, Governor. Thank you for reminding me. Requiring hospitalisation. But what I was going to say was the circumstances around those will determine whether, what actions are taken. We did not set out, and we don't have any definitive actions in mind. We will look at the circumstances. Obviously, we're going to do it quickly and make an assessment of what the risks are. And I'm sure that Public Health and the program board will be involved in making recommendations to the government as to what actions to take. And we will then immediately take those actions as we feel are necessary to protect the country as a whole and particular areas that may be subjected to this risk.
Thank you.
All right, guys, there you have it. We're going to end with that. That's the last of it. I thought these were important questions that we needed to get some answers to. We're running a little bit behind schedule, but I just want to close it off and saying that, Lenny and I have been talking about that over and over again in the studio as we've had different people come in and explain the situations and all of the information that we've been exposed to. We were primarily concerned with if there is an outbreak, what happens then? So we did ask Andrel to push that question forward for us on our behalf, and I want to know, are you going to be ready to push the button and close the borders if we have a community outbreak that, and I didn't quite see this in the reopening plan, so I'm glad this question was asked. I couldn't locate it, easily locate what the consequence was, what the outcome would be if this went badly. So it's good to know that they do have something in place as to what will trigger the consequences, that being two separate clusters that require hospitalization. So at that point, that's when they start making decisions of, is the border going to close? But not to say that I'm completely satisfied with that answer, but I at least feel more comfortable knowing that they do have a mechanism that is going to trigger conversations of what happens next. All right, guys, we're going to take a quick break. We're running way, way, way behind this morning, so apologies to our sponsors. Thank you for letting us have this very important conversation. We're going to take a little bit longer of a break this time. So sorry, not a quick break, a little bit longer of a break. Get caught up, respect our sponsors and their time, and when we come back, we'll do a quick coffee and coaching, and then we'll get right into Marketing Mondays with Anne-Marie Stephens.
This hour of Cayman Crosstalk is powered by Walk and Roll, the ideal place to relish Thai, Malaysian, Indonesian, and Filipino cuisines. For dine-in, take-out, or delivery, visit walkandroll.ky or call 949-0168. More of Cayman Crosstalk, brought to you by Walk and Roll, is next on Rooster 101.
Looking for a new pizza joint with that perfect crust? My car needs a bit of a tune-up, and my pregnant wife needs something from the pharmacy. So I turned to the printed yellow directory, and in an instant, the pizzas are ordered, the oil change is booked, and the thing that I'm not allowed to say out loud has been purchased for my wife. Problem solved. When you need something quick, do yourself a favor. Flip through the printed yellow directory. Stop searching, start finding. Yellow. We know local.
When it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the
staff or contributors. Individuals who choose to call or comment do so at their own risk and should ensure that they comply with all laws and regulations, including those relating to defamation and privacy. Have your say on 233-1019, WhatsApp message 324-1019, or find us on Facebook at Cayman Crosstalk. This is Cayman Crosstalk on Rooster 101, leading Cayman's conversation.
On Monday, the 30th of August, I'm Caroline James with your headlines from the Cayman Compass newsroom. This weekend, Travel Cayman confirmed that a number of alleged breaches of quarantine have occurred at private residences over the past 2 weeks. All the infractions were reported to authorities by members of the public. According to a statement issued by the Travel Oversight Agency, the alleged breaches involved people in mandatory isolation, engaging with members of the public, and exchanging items in breach of COVID-19 protocols. Travel Cayman said all the alleged breaches were reported to the police and are currently under investigation. In many instances, individuals were placed in quarantine at the instruction of the Medical Officer of Health and were warned for intended prosecution by the RCIPS, Travel Cayman said. In this statement, Public Health said it would like to reassure the community that the infractions were isolated and there is no cause for public health concern. And the number of sharks being killed in Cayman's waters is increasing. The latest figures from the Department of Environment revealed that up to Thursday, the 26th of August, 27 dead sharks have been reported, which is 11 more than the 16 dead reported in 2019. COVID restrictions and lockdown in 2020 meant the DOE logged just one report of a dead nurse shark that year. This count, however, is assumed to be inaccurate. For these and other of the nation's top headlines, visit caymancompass.com.
Now back to Cayman Crosstalk. Join the conversation. Call the Crosstalk hotline, 233-1019. Brought to you by Global Medical Center and Laboratory.
All right, everybody, welcome back. We are at 8:24 in the studio, and your time check is brought to you by CIBC, First Caribbean Bank. I hope that you found the previous segment helpful. We are going to go into a hard segment shift into the next direction of, and it's maybe not even so much of a hard, now that I think about it. We're going to switch topics completely, do a little bit of coffee and coaching, and Anne-Marie is already here with a coffee. Hallelujah. And let me turn on her mic. Sorry. Morning, Anne-Marie.
Good morning.
All right. So we're going to do a coffee and coaching this morning, and the conversation is lessons will be repeated until learned. So I kind of found it. I found this one interesting because one, we're back to school. Two, we are talking about the border reopening because we've seen how in other countries, BVI, Jamaica, we have to learn these lessons. Yeah. And Bermuda, like we've seen our fellow Caribbean countries, whether big or small, take on this task, and I'm hoping that we are seeing what they have been through and not just following suit or trying to just tweak it one little bit. I would be, me personally, again, this is just my personal views, I would be far more happier for us to take a bold stance than for us to just muddle through something and tweak it a little bit. I mean, again, It's easy to judge when you're not the person making the decisions, and I'm not privy to, obviously a lot of us aren't privy to all of the information that is coming at the government and the ministers. We're not privileged enough to have that information to that extent, so we don't know what's driving some of these conversations.
Right.
But we have seen where tourism as a main driver, and again, sympathy, I am super sympathetic to those in the tourism industry. But are we going to have to go down the same road of opening and closing and opening and closing, mm-hmm. or putting our country and our countrymen at severe risks because we're not willing to do something a little bit differently? My main take from a quick perspective shift is if the tourism industry ended now, right? We already lost cruise tourism. We had Roy Bodden on last week, and he said cruise tourism is dead as far as it's concerned right now. Mm-hmm. It's dead for the foreseeable future. That's it. Boom. That doesn't exist anymore. So if tourism didn't exist anymore as an option for us, what would we be willing to do instead of reviving possibly a dead horse? What else could we do?
Shifts can we make?
Yeah. And sometimes if you just take something out of the equation altogether, you start to have some other brilliant ideas, and it might take a little while, it might take a shift, it might take a lot of retraining and retooling of people, but at the same time, is that maybe a better option than putting the whole country in a space that it may or may not want to be in? So that's my two cents on that. And again, lessons will be repeated to learn. So the excerpt I wanted to just quote to you guys today and read a little bit from is a little book. It's a tiny little book about the size of my hand here. And it's called If Life is a Game, These Are the Rules. And it is Lenny has me doing some... All right, good. You got that? All right. So if life is a game, these are the rules by Sherry Carter Scott, PhD. So lesson four, and this is all about the rules and the games and lessons primarily, but chapter four is called, or rule four, a lesson is repeated until learned. Lessons will repeated to you in various, the way this quote is written is actually kind of weird. I think I filled in a word in my eyes. Lessons will be repeated to you in various forms until you have learned them. When you have learned them, you can go on to the next lesson. There's always going to be a lesson. You know, and our parents were like, Mom, I don't need a life lesson. They will be repeated to learn, and then it's just another lesson after that. So tough it out. All right. So, I'm just going to kind of read some chunks that I thought were helpful. I'm not going to read the whole thing, especially because we're crunched for time today. But it says, you will continually attract the same lesson into your life. You will also draw to you teachers to teach you that lesson until you get it right. The only way you can free yourself of difficult patterns and issues you tend to repeat is by shifting your perspective so that you can recognize the patterns and learn the lessons that they offer. You may try to avoid the situations, but they will eventually catch up with you. To face these challenges means you need to accept the fact that something within you keeps drawing you to the same kind of person or issues, painful though that situation or relationship may be. In the words of Carl Jung, is it Jung or Chung? Jung. It's like a weird, the words of Carl Jung. There is no coming to consciousness without pain. And come to consciousness you must if you are ever going to stop repeating the same lessons and be able to move on to new ones. Very, very important words there. We think that, you know, we often don't change because it's uncomfortable, right? And coming into awareness, you have to be willing to do this. So the challenge in this particular passage and this particular chapter of the book is to identify and release the patterns that you are repeating. Any good facilitator or therapist will tell you this is no easy task, since it means you have to change, and change is not always easy. Staying just as you are may not help you advance spiritually, but it certainly is comfortable in its familiarity. So, you know, these are patterns you have long established. Remember, if you wake up and this week you're like, my life isn't working for you, you have built these patterns up over years and years. So how do we start to change this? In this book, what she identifies is 1, awareness, becoming conscious of the pattern or issue. So again, you find yourself in the same relationship, dating the same type of people, in the same type of jobs. That's your pattern. Things end the same way all over. Why does this always happen to me? That's the language you're looking out for, right? So secondly is acknowledgement, admitting that you need to release the pattern. So again, when you come to Jesus moment, this is not working out for me anymore. That's the next step. All right, choice, actively selecting to repeat the pattern, or to release the pattern, sorry. So you have to say, all right, this is that thing. So once you've identified it, once you've acknowledged that you want to stop it, then you have to choose to stop it, because it's just a cycle. So when you get to that point where I recognize that this is becoming that same thing, and you can write it down, guys, write it out. Like, first I do this, then I do this, and then this happens, and after that, this happens, and then I start all over again. So if you can start to identify those step by step, this is what happens, this is my pattern, you'll start to know where you are in it. And that will help you start to make that choice and say, this is where I can do this differently. Maybe I try this. And maybe you go through that cycle a couple different times and make a choice in a couple different places. And then you understand this didn't work, that didn't work. But it's going to take a little time. Remember, you spent probably years building yourself into this pattern. It's going to take some practice and it's going to take some time to figure it out, right? So that brings us on to 4, strategy, creating a realistic plan. So you have to know, again, this is where I'm going to start identifying, and when this comes up, instead of doing this, I'm going to do that. And you have to do that in 5, commitment, taking action aided by external accountability. You have to be committed to this. You have to really be committed and be patient with yourself, because it's going to take time. Finally, 6 list here is celebration, rewarding yourself for succeeding. Many times we only look at, I haven't made it there yet, I haven't made it there. But you haven't realized that, hey, instead of going through this cycle 15 times, I'm now down to going through at 5. Or I can celebrate the fact that I no longer let it get to this point where I'm depressed or I'm super anxious. So now I see it coming and it might make me a little nervous and it might, you know, get me a little down, but at least I'm starting to counteract it. And, you know, take those little wins. Say, hey, I didn't actually go through that cycle with this person or with this event. I got myself out of it. So celebrate those, because it's going to help remind you that you are making progress. And there's a couple little things that I just, she goes on to point out in this chapter. This one is probably one of the most important that I saw, just so you have an idea. She talks about awareness in a little bit more detail. And she talks about willingness. And this is the one I want to read to you guys. So life doesn't require that we be the best, only that we try our best. And that's by H. Jackson Brown Jr. She goes on to say, the real secret to being able to change is the willingness to do so. If you are to make any progress at all in excavating yourself from the cycles that entrap you, you must first identify the patterns that keep you stuck. Then you can begin to release the hold of old behaviors. If you truly want to change, you will choose to do it and make a commitment to the process of it. However, if you rely on the thought that you should change, very important word there, should, right? You will make the decision to do so, and then you will feel a pinch of sacrifice. All right, guys. I love how she frames all of this. Let me just go on real quickly. Following the current trends and the advice of friends or the wishes of family members result in decisions. Following your inner compass results in choice. So decisions versus choices, right? One is external, one is internal. Perhaps the change you wish to make is to stop smoking. If you truly want to stop, then you choose to do so and you make the commitment to quitting. However, if you just have a nagging feeling that you should quit, you might then decide to do so and thus end up feeling like you're making a sacrifice by quitting. Or perhaps you think you need to begin an exercise regime. If you truly want to do this because you want to become healthier or more fit, then you will viscerally make that choice to do so. And you will have a much easier time making a commitment to your new routine. However, if you think you should exercise to look or feel better, you will most likely decide to do so somewhat half-heartedly and thus feel like you're making a sacrifice each time you try to exercise. So I know that resonates with me. I think it resonates with a lot of people. Here's what you need to remember. Want leads to choice, which leads to commitment. Should leads to decision, which leads to sacrifice. So I am going to leave it there. We're going to take a quick break. And I just wanted to, I forgot to mention, coffee. Anne-Marie did bring the coffee. It's from Water and the Elephant. They also, so we got our coffee. Lenny's getting hooked up with one of their delicious almond blueberry muffins. I can know you can hear the paper rattling in the back. Because I told him, I said, you have to tell us, show us the muffin. But it's in this little bag. It's a beautiful little blueberry muffin. And one of my actual personal favorites. I just pick things for Lenny that I think, oh, well, I like it. You're going to try this today. So far, so good, Lenny?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Yeah. So we've had the lemon butt, the cookies. They have both kinds of cookies, the white chocolate pecan or macadamia. I think it's pecan and white chocolate. Chocolate chip. They have some delicious carrot cakes, and they do from scratch, gourmet. That's two different people. Let me just not mix that up. They do homemade donuts in there, like that, you know. Made just for you. I went in there last weekend, and it was not this weekend gone, but the weekend before, and I was like, I didn't realize how crazy people were just coming for donuts, and they had like so many donuts out there. All right, so Water and the Elephant, big shout out to the staff there, all of them. They are fantastic, so I just want to send them all a lot of love. I've never had anything but quality food and excellent customer service, so if you haven't checked them out, please do. They're right next to the Pico's. It's the same people that own both restaurants, locally owned, and again, just phenomenal the way that they run the business. So a big shout out to them, and thank you so much for providing the coffee and the snacks for us this morning. So we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back with more Crosstalk after this.
Crosstalk will be back to leading gay man's conversation shortly on Rooster 101.
Who brought the sauce?
I brought the sauce.
Oh, I love this.
Looking for a new pizza joint with that perfect crust. My car needs a bit of a tune-up, and my pregnant wife needs something from the pharmacy. So I turned to the printed yellow directory, and in an instant, the pizzas are ordered, the oil change is booked, and the thing that I'm not allowed to say out loud has been purchased for my wife. Problem solved. When you need something quick, do yourself a favor. Flip through the printed yellow directory. Stop searching, start finding. Yellow. We know local.
When it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
Cold case. It's a phrase no investigator likes to stamp on a crime file. Here in the Cayman Islands, there are at least 20 such cases. Join us at the Cayman Compass as we bring you a special investigative series in partnership with the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service, shining the light on Cayman's cold cases.
August Home Smart Lock Pro, just $189.99. Or take nutrition on the go with a NutriBullet Go for only $36.99.
Go retro with the Avanti Retro Fridge for only $179.99. Save $40. And keep cool in the bedroom with the Aqua Cooling Mattress Pad, starting at $19.99.
Sale ends September 1st, 2021. Live better for less at Priced Right.
I want you to drive safe this summer.
Don't be lame. Know your lane.
Did you know that the right lane is a passing lane? So use it, then lose it.
Stay left, Bobos.
I love you, Mommy.
I want you to drive safe this summer.
The kids of Cayman want you to drive safe this summer. And so does CG Britcay, Health Services Authority, Island Electronic Security and Monitoring, Flow, Rubis, and Compass Media.
On Monday, the 30th of August, I'm Caroline James with your headlines from the Cayman Compass newsroom. This weekend, Travel Cayman confirmed that a number of alleged breaches of quarantine have occurred at private residences over the past 2 weeks. All the infractions were reported to authorities by members of the public. According to a statement issued by the Travel Oversight Agency, the alleged breaches involved people in mandatory isolation, engaging with members of the public, and exchanging items in breach of COVID-19 protocols. Travel Cayman said all the alleged breaches were reported to the police and are currently under investigation. In many instances, individuals were placed in quarantine at the instruction of the Medical Officer of Health and were warned for intended prosecution by the RCIPS, Travel Cayman said. In this statement, Public Health said it would like to reassure the community that the infractions were isolated and there is no cause for public health concern. And the number of sharks being killed in Cayman's waters is increasing. The latest figures from the Department of Environment revealed that up to Thursday, the 26th of August, 27 dead sharks have been reported, which is 11 more than the 16 dead reported in 2019. COVID restrictions and lockdown in 2020 meant the DOE logged just one report of a dead nurse shark that year. This count, however, is assumed to be inaccurate. For these and other of the nation's top headlines, visit caymancompass.com.
Now back to Cayman Crosstalk. Join the conversation. Call the Crosstalk Hotline, 233-1019. Brought to you by Global Medical Center and Laboratory.
All right, everybody, welcome back. It is 8:42. We're going to go a little bit over. I already know this because we need to make sure Anne-Marie gets all the time she needs to talk to us about our marketing Mondays, especially with the borders reopening and business and all of these things. So Anne-Marie says she's going to tell us how to have the right business and marketing tools. So, all right, morning, Anne-Marie. You were quiet during the coffee and coaching, but I know this is all you. This is your spotlight now.
Good morning. Thank you again for having me. So today my focus is business and marketing, having the right tools for the job. Success of your business is directly tied to the success of your marketing.
Okay.
And many business owners think that they're saving money by just saying, you know, oh, I'm not going to market my business, or I'm just going to hire some, or have my child who has no real experience other than posting selfies to manage my social media.
Right.
Right.
Uh-huh.
Unfortunately, they're doing the same thing in other aspects of their business. You know, oh, I don't need to hire a sales professional. I'm just going to go out there and wing it, or I'm just going to hire an admin person and make them do all the things that I'm not doing, essentially, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's like shooting your business in the head, right? If you don't have the right tools, the right mm-hmm. resources, the right mm-hmm. knowledge, you basically don't have a business. You will fail.
Right.
Right? You have to think of it as causing more damage. It's like putting a Band-Aid on a broken leg,
mm-hmm.
right? So no matter what you're doing, I mean, if you're fixing a car, you want to take it to the right mechanic. You want to make sure that they have the knowledge, they have the tools, they have the skills, they have the time to get the job done in the right time frame, right?
True.
So why in your business are you cutting corners,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
right? And I find it a lot with the small to medium-sized businesses. I know we're all strapped for cash. I know we're all having a hard time, but I'm talking even pre-COVID.
Right.
I just mean in general, even yeah. long before COVID was an issue for us, right?
Yeah, it's always that chicken and egg situation. Oh, well, I can't market because I don't have money and I don't have clients. So when I get clients, I'm going to market.
Yeah, but mm-hmm. then you can't get clients because no one knows about you.
Right.
Right? And in all honesty, by paying a professional, you end up saving a lot of money, right? The professional knows, okay, there's this... There's this meme where this guy comes, he's fixing a ship, and none of the young guys can figure out what's wrong, and he comes in, he's an older guy, he knocks a hammer twice, and everything works.
Mm-hmm.
And he charges them something like $10,000.
Right.
And they're like, but you just came in, and you knocked your hammer on this thing once or twice, and that's it.
Right.
And he's like, yeah, it's, you know, say $5 for my service, and the rest is for my knowledge of knowing where to hit the hammer.
Right.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
He is the professional. He has all the experience. You know, you just trying to get somebody to come in and do this slap-up job
mm-hmm.
is only hurting you in the end.
Mm-hmm.
We need to take more responsibility, and we need to take more pride and respect in our businesses, right? So
well, I'm just going to pause you there 1 second, because what you just said in terms of responsibility and pride and respect in our business, it's kind of the same mentality we get trapped into when, I just want to set that mindset thing because it's always key, right? If we go to somebody else's business and want to bargain them down and go, oh, well, we shouldn't afford that. That's too expensive. And not to say that we're endorsing overcharging for a service. That's not that. But we want it for free. We want it for cheap.
Yep.
But as business owners, we don't want people coming to us and disrespecting mm-hmm. our value in the same way, because in our industry, we understand the cost and value of the service or product that we're providing. So when you start to find yourself going out into other businesses and thinking, that's too cheap, that's too expensive, I want it cheaper, I want it, that should be for free,
mm-hmm.
it's the same mentality that you're going to attract to your business.
Right.
Lessons will be repeated until learned. So.
And that's why it's important to... If you're not aware of how to price your business, whether it's service-based, whether it is product-based, work with a professional.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in Stevens Consulting, one of our big things is ensuring that you have the right price point so that you're competitive without, you know, being run over.
Mm-hmm.
If your service has a value of $500 an hour, why are you charging $200? You know, is it what's different? Is there a valid reason why? Is it because maybe you're a startup and you want to get your name out there?
Mm-hmm.
If there's method behind the quote unquote madness, then different. You know, but if you're say your value of your product is $25 and you're trying to charge $2,500, now you're crazy.
Right.
Right? So as long as your price point is within industry standard, why discount it?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Remember, the only time people are discounting things usually is when they have an overstock of something. If it's food products, they're like, oh, we need to get rid of this before it spoils. We need to make some money back on this, right?
Yeah.
But you have to make sure that you are respecting your business enough to know that this is my rate. I'm sticking this to this rate, whether it's right. mom wants a job done or grandpa or a friend or church brother, church sister. Mm-hmm. Your rate is your rate, right?
Right.
And that is a part of, one of the tools you need for that is the knowledge, right? And yeah. you need to have that self-respect. That's a major tool that a lot of business owners don't have. They're working out of desperation. Mm-hmm. I need to make this sale.
As a tool. I like that.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
That tool is your knowledge. You need to be able to say, I'm worth this. This product is worth this. I have done the research and this is a valid price. And I'm sticking to this price. If you mm-hmm. don't want to pay this, you can go elsewhere. Mm-hmm. Simple. Mm-hmm. If there's no other provider on island, you can take it to the internet, buy it for cheap online. Whatever you have a variety of choices. But as a business owner, stick to your guns, right? Do not let people come into your business and disrespect you. And standing your ground more than anything else, reasonably, of course, mm-hmm. is a major tool that you need to have.
Absolutely. And you mentioned the point there of discounts. And, you know, it's easy to think, okay, I'm going to, you know, it is a tool.
Yeah.
Having a discount, having a sale is a tool, but you have to use that strategically is right. what you're telling us.
Yes.
Okay.
And also, I find that some people are opening businesses and they, more than anything else, they like the idea of being a business owner. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, I have a trade and business license. Yay, wonderful. Yeah. But they know nothing about the business. They know nothing about the industry. They don't even really like the business they've opened. They just figured, I need to open a business because it's just something I've always wanted to do.
Yeah.
But then they haven't done any research, so they're completely unprepared. I mean, I know people who've opened businesses and shut down in less than 2 to 3 months, right? They went and they got this big old expensive place. They can't afford the rent because they're not marketing it. They have no real plan as to how to get people in the door. They're in a hard to find location. No one knows they exist. They changed their logo 2 or 3 times.
Yeah. You're basically an employee with a trade and business license.
Not even that at that point, because I mean,
well, I say that because people don't realize that in that quadrant, there is being an employee, which mm-hmm. that's that mindset, being self-employed,
yeah.
being a business owner, and then being an investor. That's right. kind of the hierarchy, right? And people love to throw around that term of business ownership, but that's really when you have people working for you, when you have systems in place, when your business looks a certain way. So are you self-employed with a business, with a trade and business license? Are you mm-hmm. still in that employee mindset? So this yeah. is where you really, when you, Anne-Marie, are talking about taking ownership and responsibility for your business, that's where that starts to look different, not just kind of, like you said, I have a license, I
yeah.
can trade something, but I really have no idea what's going on.
Right. And I mean, too often, they're lacking the knowledge, the equipment, the mm-hmm. and worse yet, the passion. You know, it's mm. just, it's more of a status symbol, you know? Remember when everyone had to have that nice handbag, or everyone had to have that fast Ooh. Car, and everybody had to have the rims and whatever the fad was at the time. Mm-hmm. Now it's, oh, well, I have a business.
Yeah.
Right? I know people who walk into their business and they're like, oh, hi, good morning. This is so-and-so. Like, I'm the business owner. Mm-hmm. But they do nothing to push the business any further. They do nothing mm-hmm. to, on the day-to-day basis. They're not a leader. So it's not even like they're a business owner who has someone running the business for them. They just like to walk around and say, hey, I own this business, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, right?
Mm-hmm. And on the extreme opposite end, you have the people that own the business, are willing to invest, do all the hard work, and then don't own the business.
Yeah.
They don't put their name on it. They don't put yeah. their face on it. And sometimes strategically, that can be a plan.
Yeah.
But then sometimes it can also just be you're scared because
yeah.
your business might fail, so you don't put you don't own it again right. in a different way.
And I hear it. I mean, I did it as well with NAYA. I ran NAYA anonymously for 2 years because of the prejudice that I had experienced running mm-hmm. a previous business, right? I had people who were interested in my products and they loved it until they realized that it was me behind it and they weren't interested in spending the money anymore, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So as my fear from that, being catapulted out of my 9-to-5 and being told, before closing the business, you got to figure it out, I ended up having to get my own business launched. I decided I'm going to run this anonymously. I'm going to do exceptional work. No one's going to care. Mm-hmm. And I eventually put my face on the brand about 2 years after my public launch, right?
Right.
Wonderful. It can work if you do it well.
Right.
Right? There's method behind the madness, but you have to plan it out. That's where I always tell people, business plan. Mm-hmm. Write it out. You have to have a reason why you're doing everything. right? You have to have some kind of goal post to reach, and you have to know how to reach that goal post. You know, you're saying, yep, hey, I want to be successful. Well, that's not really a goal. How do you define that? You can never really achieve success if you don't define what that looks like to you personally. Mm-hmm. Because mm-hmm. success to Anne-Marie is not success to Chanda, and vice versa, right? Your goal may be higher. My goal may be higher in a different area. Mm-hmm. You know, so how do you, you can't just say, hey, I want to have a successful business.
Yeah.
What do you define that as?
Well, that, is that how many customers you've served and found solutions for? Mm-hmm. Is that how much product you sell? How much revenue you make? That
the
you
number
have?
Of staff, like the number of locations. I was just going to say,
having a healthy workplace culture, you know, what does that look like?
Yeah. Oh, I brought in $1 million this year. Great. But you had $1.5 million worth of expenses. So
you're in the red.
That doesn't work. Yeah, exactly. Right. And running a business takes more than just a business license. Mm-hmm. And marketing takes more than just a social media account. In both cases, you still need those right tools, mm-hmm. right? If you're opening a store, but you know nothing about pricing, you know nothing about displays, you know nothing about how to attract customers, you need to either invest in yourself to learn how to do that, whether it's online courses or mm-hmm. Google, YouTube, whatever it is, figure it out. Or you invest in hiring a professional to advise you to come in and consult and to get that information more quickly, but you have to invest one way or another,
right?
Because you can have the most amazing products in your store and people come in and things are just kind of hanging out of a box and thrown on the shelf and things are dusty. And if that customer experience is horrendous, what's the chances that they're going to come back even if you have what they're looking for, mm-hmm. even if it's at the price point that you're looking for, right? You're doing yourself and your business a disservice at the end of the day. For example, if you need help with marketing, learn how to do it, mm-hmm. right? Take that time. If you can't afford a professional, take the time and teach yourself. There are so many online courses. There's so many free resources out there. Mm-hmm. But I find that, I know, yes, business is overwhelming. Chanda, you know that we both know this. However, mm-hmm. if you don't take responsibility for your business, who else is going to, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. There's very likely a chance that you're going to have an employee come in and say, well, let me drive this car for you. Let me take over this business and let me just run it for you with an employee status, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Who else is going to do it for you? Your clients aren't going to demand to pay you more, right? They're always going to come in and ask for a discount. So you need to make sure that you're in charge of every decision in your business.
Correct. Yep.
If you want to work with a professional, there are a lot of marketing firms out there, you know, both locally, internationally, depending on where you're listening. So if you're listening from overseas, tuning in right now, you know, you can find a marketing firm in your area, mm-hmm. right? You can find a graphic designer to work on your logo, whatever it is you need. If you're in Cayman, we have a variety of marketing firms, everyone from major, tons of people firms, just micro firms and freelancers. There are a lot of people out there
right.
who are available to help, yeah. right? You just have to find that right fit. And what we do with Stephens Consulting is through business coaching, we help people find those resources. Mm-hmm. So if you want to start your store and you say, well, I need a location. I know what I want to sell, but I need mm-hmm. a location. Mm-hmm. I need marketing. I need all the other things. I know a lot about the product, but not about merchandising. I don't know anything about running a business. We teach you.
Okay.
Right? So Stephens Consulting is your business solutions firm. We'll go through everything from working through that business plan with you, making sure that you have everything written out. You have your map to success, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. If we realize that you are lacking in an area that you need maybe training, upskilling, we work with you on finding that course, right? If you need help to outsource certain work, say you don't need to do something in-house like your accounting, mm-hmm. we can work with you to find the right accounting firm, right? It's all about designing and building that successful business,
right?
So we are a resource. We can be that tool to help you, mm-hmm. right? If it's marketing, NAYA is there, right? But it's all about making sure that you have the right tools, the right resources, the right education to mm-hmm. be successful. Because too many times you're like, oh, well, I'm just going to start a business. Hey, 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 wonderful, great. Have no idea what it takes other than I need right. to get a business license and maybe some insurance.
Yeah. And it is taxing. Like you start off very enthusiastic, and every business owner will tell you this. Like, it goes, you have ebbs and flows, and
yeah.
There's Seth Godin has a book called The Dip, and it is one of the best books I've ever read in really preparing yourself for that entrepreneurial mindset. And the dip is everything's going good, and then all of a sudden it's like boom, mm-hmm. and
hashtag COVID.
Uh-huh, every business is going to have that dip. And it's one, do you have a plan in your mm-hmm. business plan? Have you prepared that when things go really bad, do I persevere or do I quit? And what's going to be the level, like knowing when I get out? So is it when I've lost $10,000, mm-hmm. I pull the plug, or I'm prepared to lose 10, I'm prepared to lose 20 mm-hmm. because I know that this is a $1 million business.
Right.
So I'm prepared to do that and I've planned for that. So those are not things we think of. Sometimes we're overly positive, mm-hmm. was it toxic positivity. We're not being realistic that there are going to be some really bad days
yeah.
that you might lose an employee, you might have to fire an employee. So mm-hmm. sometimes they leave on their own, sometimes you have to get rid of them and you might have to make those difficult choices and it's going to impact your business.
Yep.
But I really, every business owner or anybody thinking about going into business should really read that book, because there's going to be that time that you have to make a choice whether you can see it through or not.
Yeah.
So.
And I find a lot of business owners right now are going through this, woe is me, I must be doing everything wrong because they're not getting any business, forgetting that COVID,
mm-hmm.
COVID.
Priorities have changed.
Yeah, we are all suffering. We're all going through our struggles financially. So even if I really need your service, if there's something that I need more than that, my money goes there, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Like I need water, I need electricity. So I maybe don't have the money for marketing right now for my business, right? Maybe mm-hmm. I have to just thug it out and do those free YouTube courses, whatever it is, free online right. Resources in the meantime, because life is, we're in a position of yep. desperation.
Yeah.
You
yep.
know, we don't have the income that we had before COVID because our clientele doesn't have that income either.
Yeah, right? So you might have to go back to the bootstrapping it for a bit and then until you figured out how to pivot.
But it doesn't make you a failure.
No,
and a lot of people are taking it very personally and they're very invested and they're very passionate, but mm-hmm. they're feeling it after this long period now of the dip
mm-hmm.
and they're struggling. And I'm having to remind clients, just because it's not happening now doesn't mean it's not going to happen. You were doing exceptionally well before COVID.
Yeah.
Just, you know, you might have to take a break from the business, fine. Mm-hmm. If it's something that you can, you know, kind of put a pause on, yeah. especially if it's a service-based business, you might mm-hmm. need to put a pause on it, fine. But there's all likelihood that when the borders reopen safely, please dear Jesus, your business will be booming again.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
I have clients who had more income than they knew what to do with, and now are like, I don't have anything happening for me right now. And
right.
it's putting people into depression,
mm-hmm.
right? And it's a part of business that unfortunately we have to prepare for, and very few of us have even considered it when yeah. you open a business.
Yeah, and as I said earlier, sometimes it's really saying, like, because some of us are hanging on going, well, I'll just wait till the borders reopen, or I'll just wait, and they're mm-hmm. you're waiting, or when you have something, or when somebody does something, that's when you're going to be successful or make a move or whatnot. And sometimes, again, you just have to take that out the equation and be like, if that doesn't exist, can I still operate this business in a different way? Can I shift mm-hmm. my target audience? Can I, you know, whatever. So
yeah.
sometimes you have to remove it and be like, really look hard and true at the, mm. the circumstances and go, this doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
So what do I do with this inventory that I have? Yeah. What do I do with the service that I provide?
Is this something that I can do international sales? You know, can I advertise
right.
and
look for a different market?
Especially if it's service-based, yeah. can I do, for example, my business coaching isn't limited to Cayman. Mm-hmm. I can coach with anyone worldwide as long as we can communicate English to English or have a translator involved, we're fine,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm willing to work with people overseas. I'm not going to limit my business to Cayman, mm-hmm, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you can do the same, pivot and create a plan for that as well.
Mm-hmm,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a product-based business and you have the ability, especially if it's smaller items that you have the ability to ship overseas at a reasonable rate, market overseas and see if you can get some sales, man. There are other people who are very having such a little response to COVID where financially they're doing pretty much the same.
Right.
Because their country isn't shut down and maybe things are hard. They're having to wear their mask and they're social distancing like we were last year. But financially, they're doing better than we are because
mm-hmm.
they're still working the full-time jobs. Their sectors haven't closed down. There's opportunity. But the problem is we're limiting ourselves to Cayman a little bit too much at times.
I agree.
I mean, if you're a restaurant, fine. I understand your limitations. It doesn't work for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes you have to take a step back and say, like you said, if tourism doesn't come back, if we decide that this isn't for us, we have to protect our people, how can I pivot this business?
Absolutely. All right, we're going to take a quick break and we'll come back with more of having the right tools for your business and marketing.
Crosstalk will be back to leading gay man's conversation shortly on Rooster 101.
Are you in the mood for some delicious food?
Looking for a new pizza joint with that perfect crust. My car needs a bit of a tune-up, and my pregnant wife needs something from the pharmacy. So I turned to the printed yellow directory, and in an instant, the pizzas are ordered, the oil change is booked, and the thing that I'm not allowed to say out loud has been purchased for my wife. Problem solved. When you need something quick, do yourself a favor. Flip through the printed yellow directory. Stop searching, start finding. Yellow, we know local.
When it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
Cayman Crosstalk is leading gay man's conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
All right, everybody, welcome back. We're just rounding off this segment. We have Anne-Marie Stephens here of NAYA and a few other businesses. I'll let her go into and tell you what they're about as we wrap up today's Marketing Monday. We discussed having the right tools for your business, whether that's resources like the business services that she offers or, you know, doing it yourself, what that looks like. So I'll just let her wrap up where this segment and also... No, I'll save my thank yous for the end. I just realized this is our last segment in this spot. We might bring it back in a different way with some quick tips or something like that later on. But as far as our summer season, that this is Anne-Marie's last spot on that 8 o'clock hour Monday segment. So we've enjoyed having her. But thank I'll you. Let her wrap up with the services that she offers.
Yes, so... For all the business owners or for people who are thinking of starting a business, my firm, Stevens Consulting, we're a business solutions firm. So we can take you through everything from writing your business plan, applying for your trade and business application, working through the process of building, launching, and maintaining a successful business, right? So we have a long haul program where we work with you for up to a year once you've launched, and if you're having any issues, we coach through those, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. We have a plan, but there's always something that arises that we hadn't thought of, and we coach through those, right? So with business coaching, it's just to help clients determine their specific business goals, develop a plan, and then help them achieve those goals, right? It's about building a long-term successful business, not a pop-up and, you know, you gain a little bit of money quick time and right. You run out the door, right? We want to make sure that this is a sustainable business. You have your backup plans. You have your plan B to Q as necessary mm-hmm, mm-hmm. to make sure that, you know, life happens. You want to make sure that when something like COVID happens, you have at least some plan, even if it's not for a year worth of country shutdown, right? So business coaching helps entrepreneurs and aspiring entrepreneurs to find clarity and purpose in their business, to refocus the vision of their business if they have one already, aligning their business and personal goals. A lot of the time people are thinking, you know, oh, well, here are my business goals, here are my personal goals. But as a business owner, entrepreneur, they're not gelling together,
right?
You know, so you want to retire young, but you're setting up a business that requires you to do all the work and you haven't put in a plan to train anyone to take over. Those two goals conflict, right? Mm-hmm, so we'll help mm-hmm. you realign and create a plan to make those things happen for yourself. And as you mentioned, help you find the right tools and resources, and we build that customized system to ensure your long-term success.
Awesome.
So with NAYA, my marketing firm, we help clients identify their marketing goals based on those business goals, right? So these businesses are all tied together. So working with me, we can go from launching the business into marketing it and long-term success. And so if anyone is looking for help in any of these areas, you can reach out to me at 525-7410 or for NAYA, info@naya-cayman.com. or for Stevens Consulting, info at Stevens, STEPHENSKY.com. And we can schedule your free consultation. You know, it doesn't take you anything. It doesn't charge anything for you to come in and meet with me to discuss. And if you never sign on, you never sign on. You know, mm-hmm, there's no commitment mm-hmm. needed. There's no fee. So just but take the time you have. Yeah. And you can get some free advice. We can determine together what's the best route for you, what's the best plan for you, you know. Mm-hmm. And once you know your business goals, we'll know how to market the business as well. And it's a partnership, right? I know I'm very passionate about helping people grow the businesses that they've been so desperately dreaming mm-hmm. of, mm-hmm. you know. So before launching your business, take that time and determine what you want out of it.
It really does help. It really does help make things run smoothly.
I mean, think about it. You take a test and you haven't studied. How do you do? You usually don't pass very high if you pass at all, right? Mm-hmm. So you have to prepare, right? What happens when you don't prepare before the storm?
Disaster.
Right.
Yeah.
So just take the time, and there's no rush. Remember, other people aren't posting their failures. Stop at the whole social media.
True.
This person is so successful and they're so wonderful and they've never even bucked their toe in their life. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of times that they've been knee deep in mud. Mm-hmm. Struggling, and they will never post that. They'll never share that. Mm-hmm. They're only showing their successes. So mm-hmm. focus on you, right? If it takes you 10 years to achieve what you think someone took 5 years to achieve, as long as you've achieved it, that's what's important, right? So take the time, find those resources. And again, NAYA, Stevens Consulting, we are here to help you build the businesses that you've been dreaming of.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah. I also just want to chip in here to the workshop that Anne-Marie and I are running in November, on November 13th, the Mind Your Business workshop. A big part of that, again, is also understanding that people can't always commit to a 1 year or a 6 month monthly fee, but you can afford a one-off workshop type environment. So that's part of our reasoning and able to, how can we best serve our target audiences? How can we best serve this market and our community by being able to offer some of these resources? The things you guys have, we've heard our clients on both ends say, we need more of this, we need more of that. So we've kind of highlighted what are the things we think people really need, and giving you that in this workshop. So you can find more about that at either of our Instagram pages, at Stevens KY.com. And it's everything, all the registration is open. It's being run through StevensKY.com/events. And I also have things posted on @Chanda_V Instagram page as well, if you're interested in that. So that's it. Again, Anne-Marie, thank you so much for coming on, giving us some free advice about how and where and what we need to do to revamp ourselves in light of everything that's been going on. It's been some stressful times. So thank you so much. And I'm sure we will have you back on in
thank
one
you.
Capacity
yes.
or another.
Thank you for having me.
Absolute pleasure. And tomorrow I'll see you guys here bright and early, starting at 7. We're going to continue some of these COVID conversations, because I didn't even get into the whole ivermectin. I didn't get into the booster shots, but we have made some progress in terms of identifying some important key questions that we needed answered, and maybe more questions than answers and more questions, but that's how we get to the bottom of things, right? We just keep asking and not being afraid to deal with the responses that we get. So, all right, guys, tomorrow I'm going to also have Ruth Anna Young coming in, talking about the housing market and some advice for new property owners, whether you're brand new or, you know, new again to the property market. So we're looking forward to having her on. She's coming in around 7:30, and we'll talk to her then. So until then, have a wonderful day, and I will see you bright and early for more Crosstalk tomorrow. This is Chanda V signing out.
This is Lady A.
I'm Matt Still.
This is Hunter Hayes.
This is Gay Man Country. Rooster 101 Georgetown. Owned and operated by Compass Media. And broadcasting live to the most beautiful place on earth, Grand Cayman.